the name of Allah, the most merciful. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord of the world. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. I thank Allah Almighty for the man that has taught us deep wisdom and knowledge that will unshackle us and free us from our 400-year-old enemy. I thank Allah for the man that I'm trying to live up to be called a son of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I thank Allah Almighty for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that did not leave us alone when a critical hour and darkness came over Black America. I thank that man because he raised the Honorable Louis Farrakhan, the man that is helping his father in the mission of resurrecting the Black man and woman of America. I greet you in behalf of their name in the greeting words of peace in the Arabic language, Assalamu alaikum. Brothers and sisters, I feel very good this afternoon, as you should be feeling very good yourself. It is always a great honor and pleasure, first, to be a Muslim in this day and in this hour. It is indeed a great day to know yourself and know the enemy. Our dearest desire, those of us who are striving to become Muslims and those of us who are in this work, is that you who have been touched by the word of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad through his servant, the Honorable Louis Farrakhan, that you see that word and that you take that word to better your life. I'm very happy and proud to be in the work of my father, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And I'm so happy because if it wasn't for that man that he left, I would have nothing to work in. I would not have a mosque to come to. The work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad would have been laid to rest forever if it was not for the Honorable Louis Farrakhan. I'm thankful to that man because he's been more than anyone expected him to be. I'm saying that you and I did not believe 14 years ago when he took the first steps in rebuilding the Nation of Islam. Black America did not believe that he could bring back the word and the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Let alone white America did not believe that this man could really do it. All of the governments of the world, they plotted to destroy the Nation of Islam. And they did not believe that this man could actually do it. And in 14 years, look at where we are. Look at the mileage that the Honorable Louis Farrakhan has covered and delivering the word of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I say that this is a day that the black man and woman should stand up and be happy and glorious that we have a man of God among us. I am full because when that man comes out, I am overtaken by his presence. We have been teaching you that the presence of God has been among us for the past 60 years. And how are we given proof of that presence? That proof was given in the person of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And that proof is being given to us today in the person of Louis Farrakhan. He's a good example, and that's
what the people need after being in bondage for 400 years. They need a good example of one that is not fearful of the powers that are present. We need one that is not a coward today. We need a strong black man that is willing to give his life for the freedom of not just himself and his family, for the freedom of 30 million black people who still yearn to breathe free. It is that man that we are called by today to follow. You may say that Allah and this Quran is sufficient. I will differ with you, for the Quran says, obey Allah and obey his apostle. Over and over again, obey Allah and obey his messenger. That is to say that if you do not recognize his servant, his messenger, Allah don't have nothing to do with you after he has sent you from your own prayers a man that would deliver you. In the 25th surah of the Quran, it is called Furqan. That resembles the name that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave the Honorable Louis Farrakhan. It is called the discrimination. Let me just read to you just that first verse. Blessed is he who sent down the discrimination upon his servant that he might be a warner to the nations. The discrimination. He's a man of truth, and he separates today the truth and falsehood, hypocrites and disbelievers and believers, those who are willing to do the will of God and those that refuse to do the will of God. In the movie which touched me so, Muhammad, the messenger of God, when they show the great Caliph Ali, they show him battling with a two-edged sword. And Farrakhan with his tongue, it is like a sword that has two edges on it. Because you either hate him or you love him. You're either with him or you're against him. I feel good that in myself, that every day I am strengthened in faith to stand with that man, because I know that my father will reject me if I reject his servant. It is made very clear today, for we as the family of Muhammad have no easy road, and the door is not open to go into the hereafter because we are sons or grandsons or nephews of Elijah Muhammad. No, we have to recognize today that the man that sits in his seat is Louis Farrakhan. And in order for us to be blessed by God, we must bow in submission to him, and then blessings will be bestowed upon us. I know that. My brother Rasul Muhammad, who is with us, minister from Detroit, Michigan, is with us. Stand up. He's doing a wonderful, wonderful job in Detroit, Michigan. The whole city knows him. And he had a hard time when he first went to Detroit. But what distinguished him in that city, being a son of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, was his total loyalty to Louis Farrakhan. So my other family members there in Detroit, they were baffled that a son of Elijah, their own nephew or cousin, would give his allegiance and his loyalty and his life for Louis Farrakhan. But that's the way it is today. And that's the way it's gonna be. If we love that man, then we give our life for that man. I'm willing to give my life. How many of you are willing to give your life for Louis Farrakhan today? All praise is due to Allah. I want to say, personally, this man has been a wonderful father to me and my brothers. He's been a good father in the absence of my father. He has guided me like a father to a son. And he's also been a good father to the nation and a good father to black people. Elijah Muhammad made that possible. That is what I want you to see. That it is Elijah Muhammad from this rostrum that sat him in his feet and told us to look at him and to listen to him and to obey him. But as I said to you last Sunday, surely man is ungrateful, and sometimes we don't value the men of God among us. So Allah, after trying the people, he tries you and has you to reflect on what you had by taking away that messenger and that servant. When that light is removed and you experience darkness again, then and then alone will you realize what kind of man was among us. Today, brothers and sisters, out of your yearning and the yearning of our mothers and fathers in slavery and the fulfillment of the prophecies that a messenger be raised from among them, you and I have reached the level of no hope. We really don't believe that the God, the Almighty Creator, the Supreme Being, has any love or concern for black people. We really don't believe that. We see that the God has sent messengers to every nation, and the condition that we have suffered here in America, we don't believe that God really cares about the black man and woman. But I say to you that I bear witness that God does care for you and I. I bear witness and I testify that my father was that one that was raised from among us to guide us out of bondage. I bear witness that Louis Farrakhan is that man today that is divinely guided to lead the black man and woman out of bondage. Do you see him? When a man comes among you and speaks the way he speaks, remember that it was your desire to be free. It is your desire to be free from bondage. And when that man comes among us with his word, he speaks to you, and you are able to relate to him, because you have a desire to be free, and he speaks to that desire. That man is Louis Farrakhan today. Farrakhan, not to use it cheap, is my man. Farrakhan is your man. Farrakhan is the one that if we watch him carefully, if we follow his examples of principle, we can be in a better position today. We can actually free ourselves from bondage. Let us listen to the word of Farrakhan. Let us hear his word attentively and pay attention to the message that he is to deliver. That man, Louis Farrakhan, is on his way here right now and should be here any minute. I just got the message that he has arrived. Minister Farrakhan is in the building. He's here at the mosque and ready to speak to you and I today. I love that man with all of my heart. I love him and I'm willing to die for him. And I want us as black people collectively and in unity to show a man that has worked so hard for you and I, that we together as a family are also willing to pay the price for freedom, that it is not on the shoulders of one man. Let us show him that we also are willing to give our lives. The Honorable Louis Farrakhan. All praise is due to Allah. All praise is due to Allah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and that Muhammad is his messenger. I'm very happy to greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. I would like to take just a few moments of your time today. I did not intend to come out, but a few days ago, a thought came to me that I should like to share with you. As we attempt to run the race of life, Almighty God, Allah, has deposited within us, in our genetic makeup, certain qualities, characteristics, gifts. We, the original people of the earth, are born of God. So righteousness is natural for us, while evil is an unnatural reality in our lives that has become natural. The reason that evil has become a natural way of life is because Almighty God, Allah, for his own wise purposes, has given evil a chance to rule, to hold sway over the human family of the earth, but only for a season and for a very definite reason. We could not do evil if the germ of evil were not in our makeup. You cannot get out of something what is not in it. If we are doing evil, then you have to ask yourself, where did the evil come from? Now, we can blame white people for all the evil that is on the earth. And I think you would be very near correct, but not totally. Because the evil that they have manifested in us is from us. Now the question that we have to wrestle with is the nature of God in us, the nature of truth, the nature of love, and then the opposite of that.
God has created the universe in truth. So truth is the sustainer of the universe. The universe is nurtured on truth. The universe is maintained by truth. We are born of truth. So the only thing that can make us prosper is truth, yet we lie. Where does the lie come from? You can't say that white people taught us how to lie. They are indeed liars. But what is it in the nature of a young child that took some cookies that he was commanded by his parents not to take? And when mother discovered that the cookie was gone and questioned the child about the whereabouts of the cookie, the child said, "I don't know. Did you take the cookie, Johnny?" "No, I wasn't near the cookie jar." Well, there was no Yahoo teaching that little boy to lie. Something in the nature is compelling the child to tell other than the truth. Why? Because the child knows if it tells the truth, yeah, I took that cookie. In direct contravention to mother's instruction, mom may get the strap and my backside is going to be burning. And to avoid that catastrophe in my life, I'm going to lie about this thing. Am I didn't take the cookie. So lying and telling the truth are a part of our own nature. Well, this is something to consider. They say God is love. What is the devil? Then the devil would be the opposite of love. It's a little deeper than that. Love, I'm using now Western meaning of this word. The word is so much deeper than the dictionary would have us understand. But for the purpose of what I'm about to say, I will use Webster's meaning. Love is an intense feeling of like for an object or person. Hate is an intense dislike. What we have is the same force in our being, but on the positive side, it demonstrates itself as an intense like for something, but on the negative side, it manifests itself as an intense dislike or disapproval of an object. But love and hate is the same emotion, only the negative side of it comes up with hate and the positive side comes up with love. God has all of these things right in his own nature. For God, of course, he does not lie. He could, but he doesn't need to. He is the truth. But God is creator. God is destroyer. See? The two opposite forces or manifestation of a force are in his very nature. So we as human beings can love and hate. We can heal and we can kill. Huh? We can do both sides of the equation. The question is what decision we make to govern ourselves by either the positive side of the nature or to be on the negative side of the nature. Once you start going toward the negative side of yourself, then you are moving toward becoming a devil of self. I'm going to say that again. It is not that killing is always a negative thing. Sometimes killing is positive. Here's a man that came up in the news, trapping young men who were more than likely homosexual, killing them, then dismembering them. Killing a man like that is a positive thing. Wouldn't you say so? That's a godly thing to do. You say, oh, Brother Farrakhan, please don't talk like that. But there's a godly aspect to killing. There's a godly aspect to all of the negative things that we call negative. There's a godly aspect to hatred. Because God himself hates, but God is not negative. But he hates falsehood. He hates evil. And what he hates, he moves to destroy out of his love for the truth and love for righteousness. Do you understand what I'm saying? If you have a daughter and you love your daughter, and someone rapes your child, the emotion that comes up in us is to do what? Kill the rapist. Nothing wrong with that. That's the right way to feel. It's just that in a civilized society, we allow the law to handle it for us. So the law will say the state versus. So the state will take up our cry for justice. And a smart lawyer will get the rapist off so that our hearts are still aggrieved, no justice. In Islamic law, we don't allow a smart lawyer to get a criminal off. When we know you are the guilty party, we take the proper action. And that kind of justice makes your heart come back to repose or quiet. But when we are constantly victims of injustice and there is no means of adjudicating the wrong, then we swell up on the inside. And we can take a proper course to get justice, or we can allow the negativity of injustice to make us negative. So that we can become an evil person by looking at the evil done to us and then becoming what has happened to us. You didn't hear me. There's not a person in here that hasn't experienced some evil and given evil as an experience to somebody else. Though most of us would not like to admit that that is the case. When someone does evil to us, our reaction to evil demonstrates either the righteousness of ourselves or that we now have become the thing that we are condemning. people have a purpose on the earth, and they are more in harmony with their purpose than any black man on the earth is in harmony with his purpose. Or at least most black people. What is the purpose of white people? Their purpose was to try the human family with evil. To afflict the black, the brown, the red, the yellow, and even their own members with injustice and evil. To see whether evil is equal to good. Can evil produce the same result as good? Why else would God allow Satan to rule? To bring out of us things in our nature that we ourselves are not aware is there. Fire brings out what is hidden. If you want to know what a thing is composed of, put fire to it. Fire will break it right down, break up its form, and bring it right down to its basic elements. When you want to know what's in a human being, you apply fire to them. This book, Quran, teaches us that hell is meant for purification. God never intended for us to go to hell on any permanent base, but he has allowed us to enter into hell for very specific reasons, and that is to manifest to ourselves the weakness of self, that hell may purify us of a weakness that that fire of hell has exposed to view. Now, brothers and sisters, this subject matter will cause us not so much to look at the open enemy, the Caucasian. He's an open enemy, not a secret enemy. But he works on us through weaknesses within ourselves that he discovers and uses to further his cause to our detriment. The white people are like sifters. You know, when you have a kernel of something and you put it in a sifter and you shake it back and forth, flour or whatnot, the thing that comes through the sifter is the thing you want to use. The thing that stays in the sifter is the thing you want to discard. Jesus said to Peter, "The devil desires you that he may sift you as wheat." What do you mean, Jesus? Satan wants to try you to see what you're made of. And as a man sifts another man, there are things that come through that you want to maintain. But in the sifter, you begin to see things that you wish to remove. Every teacher tries his or her students. You call it a test. What do you give your students a test for? You want to find out whether they've made their studies, whether they understand the principles involved, whether they can pass the test. God is like that too. Nobody comes to God without being tried. Nobody. Even the most beloved of God have to be tried by God in order for God to sift them and then exalt them after he purifies them. When God has chosen you, he's not sifting you to destroy you. I want you to hear me again. When God has chosen you, he will not try you to destroy you, but he will try you to manifest what is in you that he can't use. Then in the manifestation of our defects, then God has to separate that defect from us that we may come to him in a manner that he can use us. My subject today deals with the principle of hard trials being necessary to establish the truth. I want to say that again. Hard trials are necessary to establish the truth. When something is necessary, it is vital to the success of that thing. If we say that yeast is necessary in bread, then don't try to make bread without yeast. You will not get the right result because yeast is necessary. Trials are necessary. Not to know the truth. No. God will give you the truth, or you will find the truth, but to establish the truth, to make truth the yardstick by which we measure everything, to establish truth, it's going to take some hard trials. By whom? Hard trials by those who say they believe in the truth and want to see the truth established after they come to know the truth. Now look, Jesus said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." That's a powerful statement. Here's a human family. I'm speaking now specifically of black people, but in general, the whole human family, enslaved to false concepts and ideas, enslaved to the lower passions of self, enslaved to greed, to lust for power, enslaved by our inordinate desires. We need to know the truth, that the truth will make us free. Then somebody or bodies will be taught the truth, and their responsibility will be to teach the truth and to suffer what needs to be suffered in order that the truth will be established among the people. Now let me tell you, brothers and sisters, when Jesus said many are called, but just a few are chosen, and the race is not to the swift, but to those who can endure to the end, what do you think he's talking about? The moment you hear the truth and say, "I believe it," you use it to benefit yourself. But if you love the truth, you must be in harmony with the cause of the truth revelation. What is the cause of truth? What is the reason why truth has come to us? It is our liberation. So the cause for which truth is being taught is for the liberation of black people and the liberation of the whole human family of the planet. But starting first with a very specific function, a very specific people who are most in need of liberation and most in need of truth. Jesus said to his disciples, "Go ye not in the way of the Samaritans, nor in the way of the Gentiles, but go ye to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Sending the disciples specifically with a mission to a people that have gotten lost. They are the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Israel here represents Yaakov's people. Jacob in the Bible wrestled with the angel. And when he wrestled with the angel and prevailed, his name was changed from Jacob to Israel. Yaakov's people, white people, all of their work is done under the name Israel. You and I were brought from Africa into the Western Hemisphere to live under white people and to be the possession of white people. Now you and I have become lost in the wicked way of white people. They brought out of us something that we didn't even know was in us. You can't make us a freak if freak is not in us. You can't make a man into a woman if woman is not in man. And you can't make a woman into a man if man is not in woman. Woman is in man and man is in woman. But the way we have gone about accentuating the feminine aspect of the male nature to make a man act like a woman, though he can never be a woman. This is perversion. This is an abomination in the sight of God. Huh? Any woman. Any woman that wishes to be satisfied by another woman in a love relationship is not well. Because the nature of God is that he created the woman for the man and the man for the woman, not the woman for the woman and the man for the man. But when perversity like this has come up out of us, it is because there's something in us that we have not yet come to grips with. Otherwise, you can't make a homosexual. Are you listening to me? Yes, sir. Adultery is in us. That's how easy it is to bring it out. Brother, you see a fine woman that's not your wife. You may know she's married, but you work close to her on the job. And you make your little pitch. And she catches it. And if she's dissatisfied at home and vulnerable, you may say, "Oh man, this is all right, you know." Dissatisfaction leads to a change. You got a dissatisfied wife at home, brother. We got a door and a window, a job for adultery. You didn't hear me. You did? Close the window and lock the door. Because the worst thing for any man to feel is that his wife has been unfaithful to him. A woman feels the same way. then when you are not taking care of your husband properly, somebody else will. Oh, make no mistake about it. There's too many women out here that don't have a man at all looking for some dissatisfied husband that they can help to satisfy. So if you leave the door open for adultery, adultery will come in your house. Why? It's something in the nature of us. Yeah. So God can say, thou shalt not commit adultery, but there's a whole lot of stuff that got to go behind that. If you're serious about us not committing adultery, then you got to make the man whole for the woman, and you got to make the woman whole for the man. Otherwise, you can command all day long, and adultery will happen all day, all night, and in between. Well, this again is why Jesus said, this wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. How did we become an adulterous generation? Because as men, we are not complete for our women. And as women, you have not been complete for your husband, for the men in your life. So this lack of completeness, lack of full development, this lack produces dissatisfaction. And dissatisfaction in any marriage opens the door for adultery. You don't have to go looking for it. It will find you. And you will gladly entertain it because of your dissatisfaction. Well, why did you get on that, Brother Farrakhan? I'm going after the point that white people have brought out of us the negative side of the divine nature. And we are now basking in the negative side of self. That's why the black community is filled with crime and violence and adultery and murder and drugs. We are basking in the negative side of our nature, which was brought out by circumstances that we didn't control, but white folk controlled the circumstances and brought out of us what we didn't even know was in us. Why is this? Because we as men refuse to take control of the destiny of our lives. We have put our lives in the hand of white people to feed us, clothe us, shelter us, so they manipulate circumstances to bring out of us what we didn't even know was in us. So you shall know the truth. What truth shall you know? The truth of God as the number one truth. The truth of self, the truth of other than yourself, and the truth of the true religion or nature of God. Once you know that, you are on the road to liberation, but not just liberating yourself. When you got 30 million people or more that are enslaved, that doesn't include the Hispanic, the Native American, poor white. That doesn't include Central America, South America, where you have oceans of our people. It doesn't include the Caribbean, Africa, the Isles of the Pacific. All of our people need to be set free. Truth needs to be established. But who will go for us? That's the question. You know the truth, but are you willing to suffer the trials that are necessary? Not the light trials, but the hard trials that are necessary in order for truth to be established. You got to answer the question. question is raised in Psalms, who will go for us? And the psalmist said, here am I, send me. Isn't that a wonderful expression? Now, when you make that statement, here am I, send me, oh, that's lovely. But do you know what you're saying? So many of us talk about what we want, but we're not willing to pay the price to get what we want. I want to be a star basketball player. Good. Glad to hear that, brother. Show up for practice tomorrow, and they start grinding you. Take these weights. I didn't come here to play no weights. I want to shoot. Yeah, but it's going to be rough up under the basket. You're going to have some strength. Pull these weights. Do you know what athletes put their bodies through is pain, pain, pain? No wonder they pay them this kind of money. They suffer a lot of pain to get where they are. You want to be great? You willing to take the pain? You don't want no pain. I understand. Give me a painless tooth extraction. Give me a painless delivery of my baby. I don't want no pain. I don't like pain, do you? Wouldn't you like to escape as much pain as you can? Sure you would. God knows that. But God ordains pain. So you can run from it, but you run into it when you start fooling around with God. And God don't spare even his choicest servant. He doesn't spare them pain. In fact, he gives them more, because they have to be tried to the nth degree if they are going to carry the weight of a weighty word. You don't put heavy weight on a man's shoulder, and his shoulders are not built up to carry the weight. The Quran says of Allah to Muhammad, he said, I've entrusted you with a weighty word. It's not a lightweight word, it's a heavy word. Well, you can't be no weak-shouldered, crying, punctified man and carry the word of God. You can't do that, brother. We can't establish no truth with crybabies. We can only establish the truth with men who know that there's a price to be paid. Well, I didn't think about that. I just said, send me. That's just about right. Brothers and sisters, I didn't think about it either. I heard Malcolm X teaching, and I liked what I heard. I said, I'm going to join this. I didn't know what I was getting into. I like the truth, man. I love the truth. And so I ran into the truth, didn't know I was running into a trial. I hardly got in the door 30 days before I was tried severely. I was asked to give up the only thing that I ever knew in life to make money to make myself and my family survive, which was my music. I was asked to give it up. That was a hard trial. But if the truth was going to be established in me, the truth could not have any rival. Music is a God. It demands time, and God demands time. You got to practice 8 hours, 6 hours, 10 hours, if you want to be great at whatever you want to be great at. But if God wants you as a servant, you can't be divided between music and basketball and track and blowing a horn. If you're going to be God's servant, he don't want your time divided. Give me not 8 hours. Don't give me 10. Give me 23 hours, 56 minutes, and 46 seconds of every day. That's what I want. And you can be my servant. That's God talking. You ain't never seen Moses moonlighting. You never heard of Jesus taking an extra job. I healed in the night, but I worked by day to make a few dollars, you know what I mean, to make ends meet. You never heard of Jesus, a taxi driver Jesus, a barber Jesus, huh? Come on. You never heard of Noah the barber, Noah the part-time prophet and full-time carpenter. When God calls you, he gives you a job, and that is your job. You have no other job. You make your way in God's way. No other thing will do. He don't need no part-time servant not to carry the weight of his word. Yeah. I didn't know. I just came in and got happy. Ended up giving up my music. I didn't even know that I had the ability to speak. I didn't know that. And when they found out I could talk, oh boy, did they put me to work. But they put me to work before character had developed, before the knowledge of posturing had developed. I could talk, and my talk attracted people much more worldly in knowledge and experience than I. So I made a lot of mistakes and hurt a lot of people. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad never threw me away because he saw tomorrow. He said, I'm going to hold on to this young man. One day we'll make something out of him. And I'm so glad he held on to me even through my folly. And I do the same. I try to hold on to you. Because I know what I came through to get where I am, and I know what you've got to come through if you want to get where I am. And I'm not inviting you to come where I am just because I want to extend an invitation to work to liberate our people. We need help to do that. And we need all the help that we can get. You don't come strong, you come weak and you get strong. But trials are decreed for you. They are necessary. Not only necessary for the establishment of truth, but it is necessary for the truth to be established in you, that you be tried. Not only once, but tried daily. That's why we search you coming in. We know you got sense. You didn't bring no gun here. And if you did, we took it. And if you did, we took it. Your knife, your cigarettes, your reefer, whatever you brought that is considered not worthy of the house of God, we take it from you. We'll give it back to you when you go. But that's not permitted in here. What are we trying to tell you? We're not trying to tell you don't bring your cigarettes, don't bring your guns to the mosque. We're telling you that too. But that's the minor message. The major message is don't admit nothing into your head, into your heart, until you have thoroughly searched it, its worthiness to become a part of the temple, of the mosque, of the house of the living God. Search. When you read a book, don't read it to digest everything some writer says. Read it with a critical, analytical mind. Is this worthy to be a part of the house of God? If not, I will discard. I will not feed my mind garbage. My mind is the house of the living God, so why should I feed it just anything? It's not worthy of my mind. So we become discriminating individuals by searching out, as Paul said, all things and holding fast to that which is true. Now, beloved, if we have established that principle that hard trials are necessary to establish truth, and hard trials are necessary to establish truth in the individual who is going to work for the establishment of truth, then none of us that come to God can escape being tried. Now, what are trials designed for? They're designed to bring up out of us things that are hidden. You don't even know it's there. A trial comes, something comes up. Ooh, what's that? Now, when it comes up, don't duck it. Even if it's ugly and foul in you or me, don't run from the mirror of truth. You've got to be strong enough to face the truth, not of me, but of you. My mother used to say, there's no need to lie on anybody. The truth about anybody is bad enough. I thought that was an excellent thing myself. Now, you know, brother, sister, ain't no saints in here. I mean, we're called saints. The Bible calls us saints. And we'll accept that. We're one of the saints, you know what I mean? That's nice, you know? But you know you ain't no saint. And I know I ain't one either. All of us, as the scripture says, have fallen short of the glory of God. It ain't none of us that don't need God's mercy and forgiveness and protection. Isn't that true? Well, if that is true, then the thing that we run from, brothers and sisters, is the courage to face the truth of ourselves.
Right.
Who wants to be told we're arrogant? Who wants to be told we are greedy for this, that, or the other that is in opposition to what God wants for us? We don't like to hear that. All of us want to hear good things, don't you? Come on. You hang out with people who tell you good things about yourself. In fact, they're your best friends. You don't choose nobody as your friend who say you a jive nigga. Anybody that tell you you a jive nigga, you say, well, you a jive nigga, and if you mess with me. But suppose you are a jive nigga. Look in the mirror and say, you know, Joe, you are a jive nigga, and then work to get yourself together. That's a hard thing to do. Isn't it easy to say, that nigga, she, that mother, he, that, she, they, we, but ain't never me. That's cowardice of the worst kind, when you can't face the truth of yourself. And it is only, brothers and sisters, when we can look in the mirror of truth and see ourselves stripped naked from the facade that we all put up. You know,
man.
I have a ring on. A lovely ring. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad is on it, and it's 40 little diamonds representing the 40 years of his labor among us. I designed the ring as really an apostolic ring. It means more to me than any emblem or symbol, because the man on the ring, to me, is the man that God chose to exalt, to give power over the very thing that we use as an emblem, sun, moon, and star. Man is supposed to become master of the universe. Huh? So if you meet the one whom God has favored and is working on and exalting to make him master of that, then that man means more. Because he's to become the master of the thing that is the emblem. Do you understand what I'm saying? He's not greater than the sun, moon, and star, yet he is greater. He won't outlive the sun, moon, and star, but wouldn't it be wonderful to know that a man can master the forces of this?
Yes, sir.
So I wear that man on a ring. It don't mean anything, except to me, but it don't make me something better than somebody who don't wear the ring at all, don't have any ring. But isn't this fascinating? You know, ooh, you see the ring. Ooh. Wow. Hey, look at that ring. So you're fascinated by a thing, you see? You see the suit that the man wears, or the shoes that he... Ooh. You see the car that he drives. You just ooh in it, ooh. And so the person that got these things, they step out. Are they really any better than you? Did the ring make me better? Can the ring send me to heaven? It could send me to hell if I get carried away with it. Can the car take me to heaven? Can the house that I live in take me to paradise? Then these things do not make one who possesses them better than one who does not. It is the character of the individual that makes you better than anything. Bring me some water. Understand, brother? If you get wrapped up in the thing, oh, somebody come with a gun and say, all right, I'll take that. Wait a minute. You ain't taking my Rolex. Boom, boom, boom. Take your Rolex, your pants, your shoes, and you lay it out over a Rolex. What is the thing? We fight for things, we don't fight for principles. We judge the success or failure of each of us by the things that we acquire rather than the character and the wisdom that we acquire and the demonstration of that wisdom. Did you hear me?
Yes, sir.
The sister who can't wear Saks Fifth Avenue, but she's dressed.
Where did you get those shoes?
And you make mention of some jive store in one of these malls, and you hear, as though because you couldn't afford Saks Fifth Avenue or Bonwit Teller, that you are less a woman than somebody else who could wear that. Somebody got a pump shoe on. Squeeze it, air comes into it.
Well,
I said, man, where did you get them punk shoes?
In other words, the shoe that dressed my foot means more to a fool than the wisdom that covers my head.
Thank you. Thank you.
This does not mean that you shouldn't have the best. You are the best. You deserve the best.
But you shouldn't put yourself in debt to the point where you become a slave, burdened by debt to pay for some creature comfort that you really couldn't afford
because you wanted to impress your neighbors or yourself that you are somebody. That's why all these prosperity teachings that are really good but yet bad, because you set your goal on such cheap things. I'll have a new car in 6 months. God is with me. You make God a cheap used car salesman. So the measure of faith in God is that you got a new car that you got to pay for every month, a note. And if you miss it, the white boy will come and repo it. But you are successful now because you got in a new car with $10,000, $20,000 worth of debt, and you talking about you been blessed? God don't bless you with a bill. You bless yourself with that. Come on. You like the latest hi-fi, CD, fine carpet on the floor? Nothing wrong with that. Get it if you can. But don't put the blame on God. Yeah, God bless me. God sure bless me. I called that number. Or that carpet man that I always see on TV. And he came out and laid me 4 rooms, 5 rooms, 6 rooms of carpet, and I ain't got to pay till 3 months from now. But you do have to pay, doctor. Look, God will bless you with these little things. That's too cheap for God. You can handle that yourself. You want to give yourself a car? You can do that. Just desire it. See it. Believe you'll have it. Go to work and it's yours. Because the nature of God's universe is that you get whatever you strive for. So there is nothing that you strive for that you will not have. But there are certain things that you need God's help in getting. You need God's help in the acquisition of knowledge. You need God's help in liberating yourself and your people and freeing yourself from the bad characteristics that sentence us to servitude to our low desires. You can't get that without God's help. All these things you can acquire. You can pray. Sure, ask God. But you really got the power to do that yourself. But you don't have the power to give yourself high morals. You don't have the power to keep away from indecent morals. You don't have the power to liberate yourself except with His help. So we say, oh Allah, guide me to the best of morals. See, you need help to get to the best of morals. from where we are. You can't come up out of a low life without the help of God. You can't perfect your nature without the help of God. Huh? You can't attain to the highest pinnacle of self-development without the help of God. So call on Him for the higher things of life. First, then all these little cheap things, they become easy for us all to acquire because God put them here for us to enjoy. That's why Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and all its righteousness, and all things will be added unto you. He didn't say you got to strive for it, but if you seek the right thing first, the thing that you seek will be added to you. Added to you. Not somebody giving you a burden that you can't carry, that you have to pay notes on. It will be added to you. Now, to conclude this subject, whenever God has chosen a servant, before He exalts that servant, He tries him with commands that raise the level of emotion in the servant, that tries the servant to see whether the servant is worthy to come up into the thinking of God. Emotions are what trials fire up. God, in the Quran, I'd like to read it. He said, O you who believe, seek assistance through patience and prayer. At this very rostra, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, during the Theology of Time lecture series, talking on this very verse of the Quran. And he looked around at me. And I was sitting where you are sitting, Brother Benny. And when he said, seek assistance through patience and prayer, it was not as though it was that he knew that I was going to have a heavy load on my shoulder. That I'm going to need to seek assistance to carry. But the thing that I would need to have in order to get the help that I'm asking for is patience and prayer. Man. Most of us, when we are suffering, we want relief right away. Not most of us, all of us. You get into suffering, you want an answer right now. Get me out of this now. Don't waste no time, God. I can't take it another minute. God said, we'll see about that. He don't take you out of it right away. What is your purpose, God? I'm bringing you to the threshold of pain. And when you think you can't go no more, I'll force more on you, because when I'm no longer here, can you take the pain? Can you be patient in your suffering? Can you seek assistance through patience and prayer? Surely, he says, Allah is with the patient. Now, I caught an awful lot of hell just developing as a young Muslim. Spike Lee came to visit us this week to talk to us about the upcoming movie, Malcolm X. He wanted to ask questions about the murder of Malcolm. He wanted to know about my involvement in the nation at the time of Malcolm's assassination. He wanted to know, was I envious of Malcolm X? Did I want his place or position? He wanted to know who firebombed Malcolm's home, who really killed Malcolm. Why do I bring this up? In growing up in the nation, to get where I am by God's grace today, I suffered plenty. You don't know what it's like to work as hard as you can work for a man that you love, while people are speaking evil about you and casting aspersions against your motives. If you're a good person and your thinking is right, and yet people see you as sinister and evil and will spread that kind of talk about you, making it super difficult for you to work, that's pain.
Right.
Malcolm X was one of the most dedicated workers that I know of to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I never saw any minister, none, work as hard as Malcolm X worked for the good of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam. I never saw any. If there were any, I didn't know of them. Malcolm X was Elijah Muhammad's star pupil. He was touted in the newspaper as being Elijah Muhammad's heir apparent. You know what heir apparent means? That Malcolm was alleged to be the one that would wear the mantle of Elijah Muhammad when Elijah Muhammad was no longer among us. Tyson wants to be champ again. In order to be champ again, to wear the mantle that he once wore, he must suffer. Because through his own weakness, arrogance, vanity, lack of consideration of his opponent, he lost his title to an inferior man who was highly motivated and took his championship away. You can't get cocky over nothing that you have done, because there's always somebody better coming up that you don't know nothing about. God has never made an eternal rose. He made a rose bush to outlast the rose. And whenever you get fascinated by the beauty of one rose, look underneath it and see one budding. None of us can be here forever, no matter how great we are in whatever we do. Our talents wane as we get older. There will always be somebody to step in, because God don't rely on no one man to do nothing. that one man will do what he's to do, and another man will come and finish the job or keep the job going. God is eternal, but man is finite. So we can't worship no finite person. You listening? Brothers, sisters, if Malcolm was going to step into the seat of Elijah Muhammad, Malcolm would have to be brought along the same path that Master Farad Muhammad brought Elijah Muhammad. You got to try the man. You got to put stuff on the man. You have to say good words about the man and then focus the envy of the brothers of that man on that man. Go to any gymnasium when a fighter is preparing for a championship. He hires people as a sparring partner or sparring partners, and their job is to beat him into shape. That's a crude way of putting it. But the sparring partner is working, looking for a weakness in him, because he wants to prove himself too. So he bangs. And if an opening comes, what? If he knocks the champ down, that's his day. You know what I mean? He goes back and says, I knocked the champ down. I think I'm going to be the next champ. I used to watch the way those who sparred with Ali in the gymnasium, they were trying to hurt Ali. Ali never tried to hurt his sparring partner. Only when they got out of line, he would teach them. I'm just telling you what I know. When he saw that they were literally trying to hurt him, Ali would then open up. Bah, 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 and he would really put it to him, and they wouldn't want no more of that. Then Ali would back off. He was a very merciful man. In truth, he was a wonderful champion, brother. Wonderful champion. But what is Muhammad's mosque? It's the gymnasium. For those who are ready to undergo hard trials to be worthy to establish truth. Who's your sparring partner, your captain, your lieutenant, your brother in the ranks with you, the minister, all these people that you think don't like you, putting stuff on you, that's your sparring partner, man. Don't run out of the gym and say you want to be a champ. You want to be a champ? Stay in the gym and keep on working till you get strong enough, because the brothers on the inside, the sisters on the inside who put things on you is nothing compared to what the enemy is going to put on you on the outside. Huh? Does that make sense? It does? Now follow me along. Malcolm had to be able to take envy, jealousy, hatred, and not become vindictive in order to be a savior and a deliverer of our people. Sure, Malcolm was an effective teacher, no question about it. But that's not all. Don't you know? If you can't take abuse and not return evil for evil, you can't sit in this seat. Not this seat. Not the one that I occupy. You can sit in your seat. On your seat. But you won't sit in this one. This is a mercy seat. Because you don't need justice right now, because if justice came to you, would nobody in here be alive? You don't need no justice. You need a mercy seat. That's why we sing the song, Come ye disconsolate. Where'er you are gathered, come to the mercy seat. Fervently kneel. 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 Bow down, hard-hearted nigger. Bow down to the mercy seat, and mercy will come to you. Hold on. Sit down. Sit down. You're not bowing to a man, jackass. You're bowing to a living principle working in a man that God has chosen for your damnable life. You are unfit to serve him. You are unworthy except by mercy, by grace, he draws us to him. And that's why we sing, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound to save a wretch like you. No, to save a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. I don't see by my power. I see because of God's grace. Are you listening? Do you understand what I'm saying? Do you really? Jesus put it another way. Except you become as a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Do you know what that's telling you? When you begin to think you know now. Oh, I know. Oh, yes, I know the way. I don't need anybody to tell me anything. Fine. Then watch how quickly you sink in the quicksand of your vanity. Because we all need somebody. And the somebody we need is Allah. But Allah manifests himself through people. We don't believe in no mystery God. In order for Malcolm to sit in the seat of a man who was commissioned to save us. And Master Farad Muhammad said to Elijah Muhammad, take plenty. Don't be a man that can only take a little hurt from your people. Learn to take whatever your people can give to get to them with the truth. Man, that's easy to say. That's hard to do. Because our people are so cantankerous, brother. Sometimes I feel like Moses, you know. I want to take a bunch of my friends up on a mountain somewhere. Ask them, would you like to hear the voice of God? And blow these niggas up. Excuse me for using that language. But Moses did that, you know. And Jesus was a little better. After they put the poor brother in such a predicament, he said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And you know, he's right. Most of us who do this evil to good men, we really don't understand the consequences of our own actions. I'm going to close. But the subject of Malcolm X is so fascinating because Malcolm's life to me is the most exemplary life to be studied. Because like us, he grew up and dropped out of school, and like many of our brothers and sisters, we drop out of school for one reason or another. Malcolm was a dropout. Malcolm found his way into criminal activity
like many of you, many of our people. Malcolm became a criminal. But he didn't want to be that, like we are all involved, many of us, in crime. We don't want to be involved in that. We're looking for a higher purpose. If Malcolm were not looking for a higher purpose, he never would have become a Muslim. He was looking for a way out of the life that he was living. Sometimes God will take you to jail to quiet you down, slow you down, to give you a chance to think. And while Malcolm was in prison, his brother came to him and told him of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and the rest is history. Malcolm, brilliant, gifted, but the thing that Malcolm had to develop to be the heir apparent of his teacher, he had to develop the mind of a savior and not the mind of a destroyer. Did Malcolm develop that mind? To a degree, he did. Malcolm was the kind of man that, as long as he were around, you would have somebody to always point out your fault. And I always felt that as long as Malcolm was around, I might see the hereafter, because he was always a brother who would tell you where you were wrong and point out the right way to you, as best as he knew it. I liked him for that. No, that's not the right word. I didn't like him for that. I loved him for that. I loved him so much that I would have been willing at any time before his defection to give my life for Malcolm X. If you look at any of the old movies and you see a young Louis X sitting behind Malcolm, you would hear me cheering him as I cheered the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And if you watched me, you'd see me scanning the rooftops when he spoke in the public, looking for anybody that might have some weapon that I might run in front to take the bullet so that my brother, whose life I felt was much more important than mine, would live. God knows best. But Malcolm did not understand what Elijah Muhammad was doing for him through what Elijah Muhammad was doing to him. He began to think, as I believe Spike too believes, that Elijah Muhammad was actually envious of Malcolm's brilliance. Let me stop right here. Don't you know that envy is that most hated characteristic in any human being? And whenever you find envy in a human being, you find the possibility of a devil developing. Because when you envy somebody, you actually hate them for what they have. And envy is not passive. Envy is active. You actively work to oppose the person that you envy. It's a hell of a sickness and disease of the heart. If Elijah Muhammad had that disease, he couldn't be a man of God. We can dismiss him right away. Finish with him. He's no man of God, because no true servant of God would ever be envious of his student who is excelling in his own teaching. Now look, I am a student of Elijah Muhammad, and I have now become a teacher, and I have many young students under me that I'm desirous of teaching them, so that one day, when I am no longer physically among you,
that the nation will not suffer and lose one step because these young people will step in and carry on the work. If I hear that one of these young men are excelling, all women, in the teachings, I rejoice, because that means some burden is being taken off of my shoulders. When Elijah Muhammad saw all of the good coming to Malcolm, he rejoiced. But then inside of him, he wondered, can Malcolm handle praise? Will the praise that he's getting from the people turn him? Any teacher would worry about a student who is becoming strong and powerful. You're not envious, you are cautious, and you are observant of that student, because once you start making a student powerful, the next thing you got to ask is, where will he take the people when you are no longer there? I got to know before I leave what kind of man you are. I'm not going to leave here and leave a crooked heart, a devious-minded serpent, or a vain, egotistical madman or woman to stand up over a people that I love? Hell no. How will I know what's in you? Got to be tried. That's all there is to it. That's what you came for. And if you can't stand being tried, get the hell up out of here now. Don't bother with me no more, because I'm going to try you. And I don't know how to try you better than God, but in my own silly way, I got to know what's around me. Don't you think I should? I don't want no surprises. Give me some credit for having some degree of intelligence. Smiling faces, sometimes they don't tell truth. I don't give a damn how much you smile at me. That don't cut nothing with me. Not today. Hypocrite smile. True believers smile. What's the difference between the smile of a hypocrite and the smile of a true believer? We can feign submission, but that ain't real submission. One of the laborers, one of the laborers asked me, "Brother Minister, how can I be foul?" Have to say it open, because it it was the national spokesperson. He asked me, how can I be a better national spokesman? I said, well, brother, I said, that's a good question. I think I can help you with the answer. Do you know what it means to represent somebody else? When you're the ambassador of a government, you can't even get angry unless it's the policy of your government. Because you're representing something bigger than yourself. When you are an ambassador of a government, you don't speak ahead of your government. You stop when something comes up. You quickly call the State Department to your superior to find out, how should I answer? How should I do? And policy will come down from your government. And as the ambassador, even if you disagree with it, it's the policy. You gotta carry it out or give up the post. You want all the benefits that come from being an ambassador? Well, what happens when your own State Department sends down instructions that you don't like? Can you, as an ambassador, say, I ain't carrying them out? That's the end of your ambassadorship right then. Is that right? I was the national representative, and I am that, of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a national representative of somebody else. Has to be of the kind and quality of heart and mind that he can die in order that what he represents lives in and through him. That's why a disciple of Jesus would say, in him I live, move, and have my being. But in order for Jesus to live in you, you got to die. But who wants to kill themselves in order that Jesus can live in them? That's talk, man. Paul said, I die daily for the Lord. What are you talking about, Paul? I'm killing my own desires, my own will, to accept the will of Jesus Christ, whom I represent, so that I can be a better representative of my King. Huh? Who wants to die that another man can live in you? And I ain't talking about his flesh. I'm talking about his mind, his spirit, his vision. Louis Farrakhan been dead a long time. You looking at Elijah Muhammad. I'm going to say it again. Louis Farrakhan couldn't do this work. It's not my work. It's the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. The work of raising the black man up is not divinely given to me. It was divinely given to him. So in order for me to do that work, he got to live in me and I in him. That's why Jesus said, me and my Father are one. Can you become one with me as I strive to become one with him? That's the test of your ego. Ego says, well, the leader, he wants it done that way. I'll do it my way. See, but Frank Sinatra ain't gonna be successful in here. I did it my way. What the hell are you talking about, your way? It's God's way or no way at all. It's not Farrakhan's way. It is the way of God as coming through the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That's the man. Always was, always will be. Well, I'm glad you said that, Farrakhan, because I heard the son of Elijah Muhammad introducing you. He said he would die for you. Hear the word of Farrakhan. You didn't say, hear the word of Elijah Muhammad coming through Farrakhan. Farrakhan has no word. Farrakhan's word is the word of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. He knows that. He's not being unfaithful to his father. He's being faithful to his father by upholding the man that his father said would get all 30 million. Elijah Muhammad haven't said that of not one of you. didn't tell you you was gonna get 30 million through any of my ministers.
Well, unless you come in line with me, as I come in line with him, you're not gonna be successful in raising our people. And I'll give you freedom to try it. I don't have no problem with that. I'm not afraid that you're gonna go out and raise up a counter movement. I know what you're gonna raise up. All those ministers of Elijah Muhammad that's out here now, they were some of the greatest men in America. But they're not successful today in raising dust. Because they're not in agreement with the authorized representative. Yeah? You don't have to applaud if you don't want to. This ain't no monkey see, monkey do show. Every student of Elijah Muhammad has the right to lift him up. But authority has to come through me. Otherwise, you don't have the authority to go along with your right, then you become a thief. You want to climb up another way. You don't want to come through the door that the messenger of God has set for you. You want to make a way yourself. Go ahead. I'll wait on you. Because I know what's out there for you. Death is waiting for you. Wailing and gnashing of teeth is waiting for you. Because if you cannot submit to one whom God's apostle has appointed for you, with these silly little secret thoughts running around in your brain, that you could do it better. If only the messenger had seen you first. Stop it, please. The messenger said to Farrakhan, he said, I didn't make you. Now, some hypocrite in here said, I told you the messenger didn't make it. And I said to him, oh, yes, you did, dear apostle. He said, oh, no, I didn't. I said, oh, yes, you did. He said, oh, no, I didn't. Who's the teacher here, brother? And I shut up. He said, brother, Allah made you for me. I taught you the same thing I taught everybody else. He never gave me no private teaching. I can count on my two hands how many private consultations I had with Elijah Muhammad. Where's all this coming from? And I don't read no books. I am a book. He told me, you go and stand up, and Allah will speak through you. I'm not putting this out here for no vanity. That's not the purpose. The purpose is to say, Malcolm X was tried by the circumstances within the mosque, by the envy, the enmity, the jealousy of his peers. And Elijah Muhammad directed the heat of that enmity and jealousy right toward toward Malcolm, to burn him in the searing flames of his brother's hatred. Because if he couldn't take it
inside the mosque. Then what would happen when the master teacher was no longer here and he's sitting in the seat with power over the people? How would he use that power? When people speak evil of you, and you know in your heart that you are right, and you got power in people that will do your bidding, that's the greatest test for your character. Because there are people in the ranks that would literally slaughter my enemies if I was that kind of man to direct them in that way. And that's a fact. I don't even have to say it loud. I just have to hint it, and the person would be dead. But that's not my work, killing my people. No. I'm going to win them by doing exactly what that New Testament said. See that scripture that says, love your enemy? It ain't talking about loving the Caucasian. He's a natural enemy. But black people, they're enemies out of their ignorance. If you don't love your people, even though they're enemies out of their ignorance, how will you find the methodology to remove the ignorance that made them your enemy, then turn them to be your friend? That's why the story of Joseph in the Quran is the most beautiful of all narratives, because Joseph was hated by his own brothers, but he maneuvered and won his brothers and then forgave them, and they worked and walked together. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, forgave his enemies when he conquered Mecca. We are so hateful and vindictive when anybody speaks evil of us or does things that we dislike. We dislike them, and if we had the right or power, we would move on them. You can't be in the mercy seat with that kind of spirit. Malcolm X, when he felt that Elijah Muhammad was envious of him and through envy had set him down at the height of his career, his anger was kindled. And he turned against the man that made him what he was. Now, if a man would turn against a teacher that gave him the opportunity, the platform, and the wisdom to hold the platform, then you and I don't have a chance. And when Malcolm turned on Elijah Muhammad, he knew something of Elijah Muhammad's domestic life, meaning that Elijah Muhammad had wives other than his wife, Clara Muhammad. And this comes as a shock to people. Why? Have you ever read the Bible that any prophet of God had one wife? Talk to me. No, let's talk. I just love God's prophets. I love them all. They're just wonderful men. How many wives did Abraham have? He was the father of the righteous. If having wives make you less righteous, then how could Abraham have ever gotten to be the friend of God? Talk back to me.
many wives did Moses have?
Come on. Well, you don't know, so go read. You so believing in the Bible. I believes in it, you say, from one cover to the nether. You're a liar. When somebody quoted to you and you don't understand the passage, you start fighting immediately. What? Then probably that more than one wife? Yeah. David was the prototype of the Messiah. How many did he have? Talk to me. So Spike asked me, wasn't it because Malcolm held Elijah Muhammad up on a pedestal? And when he found out that he had sex with his teenage secretary, he was disillusioned. I said, I could believe that. If it were true. I said, you mean to tell me Malcolm got disillusioned because Elijah Muhammad had wives and some of them were teenagers and then went to follow Prophet Muhammad who had more wives and one of them was a pre-teenager? You mean he could follow a dead prophet who had wives that never did nothing for him? But he couldn't stand with a man, came up out of the gutter and made him a giant in the earth because he had wives? That's a weak, weak. Malcolm went to Africa. He was in Ghana. He met many chiefs over there. And all the chiefs in Africa ain't got one wife, you know. And they're not limited like the Quran limits the Muslim. These chiefs may have many wives. He didn't find no problem meeting the chiefs, honoring the chiefs, sitting down, breaking bread with those chiefs that never did nothing for him, but he couldn't continue to walk with the chief that made him what he was. These are the sons of Elijah Muhammad. Come out, Ishmael. Come out, Rafi. No, no, come up front. They're just some of them. God is wise. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad had six sons before any of these were born. But not one of those six carried on Elijah Muhammad's work. God saw all the way down, and he gave Elijah Muhammad wives from among the believing women. And from those believing women, he produced believing children. Are you saying Sister was not a woman? Best of my knowledge, was one of the believing women, if not the best. But sometimes you can produce children and they don't walk in the footsteps of your husband. God knew that. So here are youngs of Elijah Muhammad, who at this point in their lives want to continue the work. I'm very happy over that, because any father would want to see his sons get involved in his work. I'm a father. I have sons. I would wish that all my sons would get involved in this work. They benefit from it. They ought to help me in the work. I have one out of four. The second one and the third one is on the way. I hope the fourth one is too. I would be a blessed man if all my children believed and help me. But that doesn't always happen in the life of the prophets and in the life of the servants of God. Sometimes good men have the worst kind of children. Am I lying? I pray that the sons of Elijah Muhammad and the sons of Farrakhan, I'm talking about biological now, will stay in the path of their father and will work tirelessly, unceasingly, whether Farrakhan is living or dead, present or absent, to continue the work of the noble man that ever walked among us, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But I'll tell you this, ain't nobody gonna come into no leader here because they the son of Elijah or the son of Farrakhan. That's dead. I want you to hear me good. I'm gonna say it again.
Well, what are they doing up there then?
I'm putting them in a position to either fly or die. Say, I give them a chance. And if they blew it, they blew it. Canceled out. Ain't no blood thing here.
Well, why is your daughter over the MGT and the GCC then? Sound like nepotism to me. Shut up. Where were you when my family was eating food out of the streets when we were poor and hungry?
You weren't there. My family was. Where were you when the enemy firebombed my home when they were children to kill me and my children? You weren't there. You don't know nothing about eating beans day in and day out, year in and year out. Maybe you do. You didn't start this movement or restart it. I'm not here because of you. You're here because of me. So if God blessed Mr. Ford to start the Ford Motor Company, Ford would be a fool not to make a place for his own children. It's my duty as a father to make a place for my children. And if they're not qualified, they won't be there. But leadership of the nation, that ain't no family thing. We all are the family. The most qualified among us don't have to come from the bloodline. Because I did not come from no bloodline. I was like David out in the field. All the bloodline was busy looking for the money line. The
Don't tell me I know the history. You didn't work for your father. I did. I fed most of them with the money that I brought here to Chicago back in the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. This is no gift for me. I earned this. I earned this the hard way. I worked for it, sweat for it, suffered for it to make a place for you. You don't have to accept the place. Hell, we won't miss you. Any one of these young men in here, older men, I'm telling you that the nation belongs to you. And the best among us who will study and work hard and say, I'm willing to undergo the hard trials necessary to establish the truth. Come on then, brother. I will lay the knowledge at your foot. You take it and run with it. And if you're the one, God will exalt you. Don't try to exalt yourself. Let God lift you up. And the whole nation will see your good works. And no one will be able to deny you because they happen to be blood. If they're not born of the spirit as well as the blood, they won't make it here. Is it clear? I love the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and I love his children. And I see it as my duty to try to make a place for his children in the nation that he himself is the foundation of. But the children can't have no contrary ideas. Not in here with me. Let me make myself very clear. I'm not doing this for vanity. Don't sit around and be angry because everywhere you go, you see people say they love Farrakhan. I didn't go out here to produce that. I just did the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and it produced it. You want the people to love you? Come help me do this work. Now, if you don't want to help me, it's okay. If you think you can be successful outside of me, then I say, go ahead and try. I will not bother you. But I'll tell you like the messenger told Malcolm, I have your key. And I have your key. Right. Yep. And you see. Brother, I'm not boasting or nothing. That's unworthy of any of us who want to be servants of God to be boasters. But he gave me the key. He, Elijah Muhammad, that's who I'm talking about. And evidently, I must have it because I'm opening doors. If you don't have no key, well, how are you going to get in? Just let me open the door and you go in. But you got to come in behind me. That shouldn't be a problem, should it? But it is. So I'm going to close now. My poor brother, Malcolm, is no longer among the living. I loved him so,
But when he turned against the messenger, the love turned to hate. And that's the way it will be with all of us. When you love Elijah Muhammad, you will hate those who actively work to oppose him. You can't help yourself. And you know what? It'll happen in your own families. You become divided over me and what I represent. Just like the Jesus said, think not that I come to bring peace, nay, a sword. I come to put the mother-in-law at variance with the daughter-in-law and the son-in-law at variance with the father-in-law, and they of a man's own household will be his worst enemy. See, when you put this kind of truth in a house, people will fall to one side or the other based upon how they relate to a person and personality in whom is the embodiment of the principle of that faith. We became divided because our man began to relate to Elijah Muhammad. When he no longer related to Elijah Muhammad, we who loved Elijah Muhammad no longer related to him. And in that, bitterness, anger, hatred rose up. And the climate of murder was set up. Well, did members of the nation kill him? I don't know. I really don't know. But I can tell you this. There was no member of the nation who loved Elijah Muhammad that would not have killed Malcolm. I'll say that again. I'm going to say it again. The spirit of the whole nation was against Malcolm's life. We as a group did not do anything to him. But among every prophet's community, there's a group. There always was and there always will be. A group of zealots. They may be just a janitor in the mosque. Some simple, when I say simple, I'm not talking about mine, but I'm talking about a simple person that you don't think too much of. They may be a clerk, typist, or somebody who just runs errands, but their heart is full with the love of that prophet. And whenever the prophet is attacked, those persons will rise to kill the enemy. And they'll go right back to sweeping the mosque. Listen to me. And I told Mr. Lee, as it was then, so it is now. As it was then, so it is now. We love Elijah Muhammad. We know what he did for us. We know what he did for Malcolm, and we know what he is doing for tens and hundreds of thousands of others. And we just are not going to stand by and allow his name to be dragged in the mud when he has done so much for all of us. We're just not going to do it. I thank you all for your kind patience this afternoon. And I hope and pray that each of us, will recognize that it takes hard trials to establish the truth. The last word I will read from the Quran, after Allah asked us to seek assistance through patience and prayer, he says, speak not of those who are slain in Allah's way as dead. Nay, they are alive
but you understand not. This verse of Quran is pointing out some of the trials that are going to be necessary to establish truth. Some of us may go to jail for the truth. Some of us may be killed for the truth. Some of us may be beaten for the truth. Some of us may lose things that we love for the sake of the truth. That's why we are told, seek assistance through patience and prayer. And Allah is saying that even if we are slain, if we are slain in the way of Allah, don't think that we are dead. Say, we are alive, but you perceive not. You know how beautiful that is? I wish I had time to explain how you can be physically dead and yet spiritually alive. Maybe there'll be another time. I would love to share that knowledge with you. That the righteous do not die. You just bury the house that they lived in. But the spirit of them, the mind of them, the wisdom, the vision of them, that's alive. And God at another time will raise a body. A body. And that mind and vision of that great righteous one will come into that body. And that person will be living again, only in another form. You didn't understand that, did you? How else could the scripture say, in that day God will pour out his spirit without number, and you'll see all the old prophets walking around. You see Abraham, you see Noah, you see Lot, you see Moses, you see David, you see Daniel, you see Joshua. Well, you ain't going to see the form that they lived in, but you'll see men and women with their same mind, their same strength, their same vision, walking now in a new body. They are not dead, but you perceive not. And we shall certainly try you with something of fear, hunger, loss of property, and lives, and fruits. I told my son, if I'm killed for the sake of the truth, don't turn back on your heels. Go forward. I don't expect to be killed. I want to make that very clear.
Right.
I don't think they got a gun big enough.
Right.
Not as long as I know who Allah is and he is with me. Not unless it pleases him, they can't do nothing to me.
Right.
And I'll stay here and dare them to do it. Shoot. I said shoot. That is what I said. Take it any way you want to. But I said shoot. Don't be afraid, young brother. Don't be afraid to accept the responsibility that's going to bring trials into your life. Don't be afraid. When you run from that, you run from the thing that will manifest you as a great man and a great woman. Don't run from that. Run to it. Maybe one day we'll be hungry. We won't be able to eat. White folk may not sell us any food. And if we don't have our own farm and growing food, we're in a little trouble. Have you learned how to fast? You ought to. Suppose he comes to take our property. You know they took our bank, they took our planes, they took our land, took everything we had before. We were tried with that loss, weren't we? Are we back where we were? and going to get it all back and then some. No, that's the way of God. He'll try you, then he'll give you more than you had. So give good news to the patient who are steadfast under trial. May Allah bless each and every one of you. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart for your patience with me this afternoon.
Thank you.
I want to thank Minister Rasool from Detroit, Michigan, for spending the day with us. Very happy to have you with us, Brother Rasool. And of course, Brother Ismail, I thank you for your spirit. I thank you for your words of love and devotion and dedication. And I pray that Allah will bless you and make you into the wonderful minister that your father said you would become. And I pray the same for all of the children of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and my own children. And I pray the same for you, that you all will grow in wisdom and power, and let's liberate our people and make a future for them and a future for ourselves. Mr. Craig Hodges is here of the World Champion Bulls. I'd like to take this opportunity to say to Brother Craig, we really enjoyed your magnificent play on the court, and you got the championship ring that you really deserve. But I'm more proud of your great championship pursuit outside of the basketball court. And let us give Brother Craig Hodges and all you young brothers, before you leave, you be sure to get Brother Craig's autograph. He's your brother, he loves you, and he wants you to be a champion. Not just a champion basketball player, but he wants you to be the champ here. Thank you very much. As-salamu alaykum.